Howdy Tubers, welcome back to the Zach Lab. I got a quick little video I want to throw together. There's kind of some misconceptions there seems to be about the balance of these pumping units. And I'd like to sort of clarify some of that. The transmission is actually out in my F-150. And I took it to a shop the day we left to go on vacation, which has been over 2 weeks ago, and went and ordered a new transmission from Ford. And the stupid transmission still hadn't come in, so we had to get the filthy whore out today and air all the tires up on it. Well, as with all of my videos, every time I pick the camera up, the wind starts blowing. So I wanted to do, we're gonna talk about the balance, and I wanted to use this unit. This is the one that we rebuilt. I added a bunch of crap to it, you can see up here. Got some headers that are kind of flopping around. There's so much crap in the bolt holes, I couldn't get the bolts to get tight. They were rusty and it tapped. So I had to get back in the pickup here, get out of the wind so I can talk to you for a second. There seems to be this idea that comes through in a lot of comments that the weights offset sort of the load of the rods and the pump and the fluid and everything else. That the only thing the unit does, so to speak, is to overcome frictional losses. It just sort of sits there and freewheels. You know, the motor just sort of keeps everything moving. And this is incorrect. You know, the weights are used to offset some of the weight, but the horsepower that the motor puts out is being used to lift fluid. I went over, kind of talked about pumps before. I'd like to do an in-depth video of it at some point. I will at some point. I just hadn't got it done. But you effectively got a plunger that gets a slug of fluid. It's, you know, on the bottom of the rods and picks up a slug of fluid. There's a standing valve, it's a check valve at the bottom, so when the rods and the plunger come back down, the fluid doesn't fall back with it. The fluid falls, or the plunger falls through the fluid, and then when it on its way back up, it's got a valve that shuts and it gets another slug. This being said, depending on what the diameter of the pump is, you know, the larger the pump, the more surface area, the harder it is to pick up, and the depth of the well, or more specifically, the differential between the fluid that's in the tubing and the fluid that's in the casing, which a well like this is pumped down, so effectively your depth. The size of the pump and the depth of the well determines how hard it is to pick that fluid up. Now this is disregarding rod weight and everything else. This is just the weight of the fluid. This has got an inch and a half pump in it, inch and a half diameter, 1600 feet deep. It's probably about 800 PSI downhole pressure. So whatever the surface area is of an inch and a half, would be, I don't know, what would that be, about 2 inches or something, probably square inches. I have to check the math on that. Times 800 pounds would be, you know, 1500 or 1600, I would guess, without having a calculator in front of me, pounds to pick up the fluid. This is not including rod weight or pump weight or frictional losses or anything else. So there's a very key point to this video, and I was trying to make it in that segment and I completely blew it. And so this is the same thought, different place, take two. It takes 1500 more pounds of force to pick up the rod string than the rod string weighs, and that's because you're picking up fluid. Now when the rod string starts back down, you don't lower the fluid back down, so that extra 1500 pounds of force goes away. Now this is supposed to be in a perfectly balanced world, a perfectly balanced unit. This is to be offset by the weights of the unit. Now, typically you would have, say in this situation, like 750 more pounds of weight than you have rod weight. And so when you go to pick up the rods, you only have to pick up 750 pounds. Does that make sense? When the rods start back down and the weights start up, now, the weights weigh 750 more pounds than rods. I feel like I made that more complicated than it should have been. But the point to be made is, you know, there's been an idea passed around in the comments that this is supposed to be perfectly balanced. It's just a teeter-totter. The gearbox just sits there and works it back and forth. And that is not how that works, because the horsepower is consumed in lifting fluid. You know, it takes more force to pick the rods up because you're picking fluid up than when the rods go back down, because you're not lowering the fluid back down with it. Okay, so this is three-phase 480, for those of you that want to do some power calculations. And basically, here we are. It's pulling. I can't show you both at the same time, but right there starts the upstroke. The peak is picking up the rods. sort of about halfway. The upstroke, it falls back to about 5 or 6 amps, about its baseline, and it hangs out there the rest of the time. So this peak is the acceleration of the rods and the fluid and everything else. After it's sort of in its mid-stroke, after it's about right there, we're back to about 6 amps. It's just the right there to right there is kind of the peak, and it's when it's accelerating the fluid, the rods, you know, the weights back down, when it's accelerating everything up the hole. So let me give you a crash reminder of sort of what went on here. I got to set up where I'm going with this. Right over there is a black unit with a yellow head. Not sure if you can see it. Y'all make fun of me for saying that, but nonetheless, there's a well over there. That well over there makes more oil than this one does. It's a better well. And anyway, it had a saddle bearing. The saddle bearing was wore completely out and it needed rebuilt, as did this one. And so what I did was took this one home, which had that black one on. I took the black one home, rebuilt it, and then set it over there. I took the junkier one, pulled it off there after that one was set, took it home and rebuilt it, and y'all watched me do it. Then we brought it out here and set it on this well. So these units were supposed to be exactly the same model. They were supposed to be identical, and driving by them, they look the same. They are both D18 Americans. They are the same model number. They should have been exactly the same. And I actually swapped the motors out because if you swap the motors, you know, the gearbox and everything's the same speed. I don't know if you can see that over there, but it runs slower. It makes less fluid, makes less water, even though it makes a little bit more oil. It doesn't have to run as fast. And so I ended up with the same, you know, the units ran the same speed as the old one did when I switched them out. Thinking these were the same, I didn't realize till later that this is actually 25 beam. So it's a longer distance between the front of the head and the Samson post. That caused a bunch of train wreck with me not having enough weight. If you want to go watch the train wreck, you can go see it. What's going on now is that the stroke is longer. It's probably like a 30 inch stroke instead of 24. Or, I mean, I didn't measure it, something like that. And so anyway, I'm moving more fluid now than I need to, and the well is pounding fluid. Now, I've been over this before. There'll be a link in the description. You can go watch the, I kind of talk about pounding fluid in detail in a couple other ones. You can see about, I hope you can see, but right there, it pounds fluid. So it means at top about 6 or 8 inches of the stroke, there's nothing else for it to suck up in the bottom of the pump. The fluid's actually falling back with it. So as this thing's pounding fluid, if I shut it down, it'll look really rod heavy. See how it just really took off? You're like, golly, that thing needs a bunch more weights. So I'm gonna leave this down for about 5 minutes and I'll catch you back and we'll take a look at it in a second. This down about a minute or two. Now then, if you can see, that fluid pound is gone. It's right there at the very, very top. There's no jar the fluid there. And so now then, even if I wait and shut this down in the mid of a stroke where it's moving the fastest, you don't get that hard acceleration. And especially if you've got it running and maybe you shut it down right there, see, it's a little bit rod heavy, but it's really not that bad. So I came out here and picked this one both because I think it'll make a good clickbait photo with the engine on and everything, but it is out of balance about as much as I personally would be okay leaving one. I'd like to take this to more of an extreme too. You know, if you had a well, say you had this particular setup without any weights on it, and it was extremely rod heavy, you would have to have a bigger motor for one thing. This motor wouldn't have enough power to pick it up. But if you have a three-phase motor and you try to drive that motor faster than its synchronous speed, it'll start generating power and putting power back into the grid. And if you had a 10 horsepower motor on it, this is a 5. If you had a 10 horsepower motor on it and no weight, all that extra power that's used to pick the rods up would actually be dumped back into the motor and turned back into electrical energy as the rods went down. It works like regenerative braking is what I was trying to say. Now, obviously there's a lot of frictional losses. There's a lot of efficiency losses in turning electricity into horsepower and horsepower back into electricity and stuff like that. You know, it's not it's not a great thing just to put a bigger motor on a unit instead of balancing it. But my point to be made is it's not like it's a, just a ton of wasted energy that you throw away. It's not going to just triple your electric bill because you're, you know, too lazy to stack a few more weights on it. So I hope that made a little bit of sense. I wanted to make the point that, you know, having a unit out of balance is not something that's going to triple your electric bill. And that seemed to be sort of a common theme. Now, I need to add, too, that this is a setup for a shallow well. You know, this well is, I think it's about 1,600 feet or maybe about 1,500 feet. When you get into deeper wells, you know, 4,000 or 5,000, they make a lot less fluid. You know, where most of your weight is not lifting fluid, most of your weight is actually rod string. You get in a little bit different situation like that. But if you've got a 500, 600, 700, 800 foot well, 1,000 foot well, you know, with, you know, 3/4, 5/8 rods in it, it's just that the balance on those being perfect is not really that critical. It's not that much more load on the gearbox. It's not that much more load on anything else. It's just not that critical. So the second part of this is I would like to talk about efficiency and where something like this does lose a significant amount of efficiency. And so if we look at this thing where it's pounding fluid, you can probably hear it in the gearbox better. You can see it. But we're going about maybe a third of the way down, something like that, before we pound fluid. And so what this means is it's picking this slug of fluid up 36 inches, and then it's falling back down, you know, like 10 inches or something. So you're picking up a significant amount more fluid than you need to, and then you're just letting it back down. That's a significant efficiency loss. And I would like to take this thing, we're gonna slow this thing down a little bit, and I'll show you how much less peak current it's gonna pull. Now, to get an idea about how much we need to slow this down, we need an estimation of how much fluid it's actually pounding. And I'm gonna say that it's probably hitting about a third of the way down, which means it's hitting about 2/3 the stroke of the water of fluid. And so basically, we need to slow this down to run 2/3 the speed it's running right now. Now, I don't want to actually get it that close. We're probably going to shoot for slowing it down by about a fourth. Slowing it down by a third would have us right on the edge, and as a pump gets worn and stuff like that, we don't want to be quite that close. So I'm just about out of battery, and I'm probably fixing to die here. What I'm fixing to do is I'm going to roll the belts off. I guess I can keep you here till I run out of battery, huh? Roll the belts off. I'm going to pull these bolts out of the shiv, and we'll pull this shiv off, and I'm at 1% battery, so I'll catch you back at the shop. All right, so I ran home and put this in my big blaster and blasted it. I don't know if you'll be able to read the numbers here, but this says 2B38SH. And what that means is it's two big grooves, and the effective diameter is 3.8 inches. This is not the OD, but it's the amount of, if you take 3.8 times pi, that'll give you the amount of belt that travels in one revolution. It's the effective diameter. Now, a 3.4 is the smallest QD style hub that they make. I needed to go to about a 3-inch, and I had to go to a one piece here. So I'm gonna run out there, go put this on. It's only been down about 10 or 15 minutes, and get it back running. I'm gonna eat lunch, and I'll catch you back out there in a few hours. We'll kind of let it stabilize, and we'll take another look at it. So it's been running a couple hours. It's 4:30. Look at the difference we've got here. We went from peaking about 9 amps or something. I'll replay the video. I don't remember. Down to it's just picking up like an extra amp or something on the upstroke, peaking about 6 or something like that. What a difference. Something that's more interesting, with since it's not going so fast, when you shut it down, you don't get it, it doesn't run back through itself. Isn't that almost amazing? I swear I didn't add any weight to this thing. Without it pounding fluid now, with it running slower, even if we shut it down right there, it just barely rolls through. So I'd like to jump back on a tangent here, talking about speeds and shivs and stuff. So the shift we put on there was a 3-inch. And I kind of explained before, but let's shoot again. This is a 2B38. That means it's got an effective diameter of 3.8 inches. Now, all the time I hear people, you know, people have been in oil field their whole life. They'll come into the supply store and they say, I need to slow a unit down a couple of strokes. What's the rule of thumb? And everybody says, 1 inch of shiv equals 2 strokes or something stupid like that. Everybody thinks this. They've got some formula for you go up 1 inch of shiv, it makes it run a couple of strokes faster or something stupid. And it's so easy, yet no one figures this out. And all you do is you take your original shiv effective diameter. Now, you can't measure OD because that'll throw you off a little bit. But nonetheless, it still, I guess, would get you closer than guessing, you know, a stroke or two, an inch. But you take 3.8. So we'll take our strokes per minute. So let's count strokes per minute of this thing. Start there. Nine and a quarter, 9.5, 9.75. We're gonna call that 9.75 strokes per minute. So if we want to figure out how fast it would go if we put this shift back on it, or whatever, you can take 9.75 strokes per minute, divide it by 3, which is the size of the shiv, times 3.8, which is the size of this shiv, it would be going 12.35 strokes per minute. It's so easy. You take strokes per minute, divide by the shiv you've got, multiply by the shiv you want, and it gives you strokes per minute. And somehow or another, nobody that works in the oil field can figure that out. So what's the moral of this story? Well, the truth is, I'm not really sure. I feel like this video was all over the place. I hope y'all followed it enough to make a little bit of sense and enjoy watching it. But I guess, in essence, it's that, you know, people are worried about these little shallow wells being perfectly balanced. That's not really what matters. If you over pump them, if you run them too fast, or you got too big a pump in them, I probably ought to back up and say too, you know, having 1 pound fluid, just the only thing that means is you're pumping more fluid, or you're attempting to pump more fluid than the well's producing. And this can be done by a unit running too fast, longer stroke, larger diameter pump. You know, the combination of the three determine how much fluid you know, your pump package is going to move. In this particular case, you know, by mistake, I put a unit back on here with a little bit longer stroke. We were able to slow it down a little bit, and it probably uses less electricity now than the shorter stroke did, because you know, the rods are moving slower through the fluid. You don't have the frictional loss of that. If I guess you consider that friction, you know, the rods to the fluid in the tubing. The rods will make less trips, you know, they'll last longer, the pump's going to change directions less often, the valves will probably last longer, the tubing will last longer. I think anytime, for the most part, you don't want to go to some stupid extreme, but for the most part, when you can slow a unit down, either by putting a bigger one with more stroke or a bigger pump in it, you're usually better off. Like I say, if you get something, you know, you try to run super slow, that's not what I'm getting at, within reason. But I guess that's about all I got to say. I appreciate you watching. This will be part, I was going to say it the first, I forgot. This will be part of the Oilfield 101 series. The playlist will be a link in the description you can click on, take you through at some point. I'd like to have videos about all different aspects of the shallow well world life. I know I hadn't had many videos out. You know, we made a couple of trips to Colorado. I've been doing just the bare minimum I can get away with keeping stuff running. It's kind of difficult to explain to someone that's not here, but when I take a week off and go somewhere, when I come back, I spend weeks trying to get caught up on the stupid monotonous stuff, sometimes as simple as paperwork, but checking oil and things and greasing things, you know, that's, I spend a lot of my time pumping grease, and I sort of got to get caught back up on the stuff that's maintenance and critical before I can start doing things that are interesting. I'm kind of getting caught back up. I got several projects that will be videos. Hopefully I have one out every week the next couple of weeks. But I'm done. Day's over. Friday. I'm gonna go laying, sit down in my chair and see if I can get y'all a video edited and put up and get it up for you tomorrow. We will catch you on the next one.